Surprise! I'm live. Okay, before you click away, okay, this is definitely Sean and Chloe session. Don't get me wrong, don't click away. Okay, so what is going to happen is that today is a bit special because I am, instead of having them here live, right, we are having them watching together with us. Okay, let me click away the banner first. So we are having them watching together with us, and I'm going to be streaming for you a pre-recorded video of them dissecting the stock Tencent, okay? And then at the back part of it, they are going to be sharing with you three ways where you can actually build your investment portfolio. So be excited, because I'm super excited. So let me just start the stream right away. And at the end of the session, I'll be teaching you how to get access to Chloe's ETF workshop, okay? So let's do this.
Baidu a bit more popular for foreigners, but I went to check the Sogou is look at the color lah, it's like Google lah, correct? Now and the thing is this, they already overtake Baidu, you know. I went to check. They already overtake Baidu since about 10 years ago. It's just that we don't know. Meaning to say their revenue, their growth, their user base, right, is bigger than Baidu. Okay, so it's something amazing. Imagine you own the Google of China. Imagine you own EA Sports or Active. Okay, they call Tencent more like a EA Sports. Now, and you know, the whole entire US, by the way, you thought that Tencent is only in China, right? Okay, they actually own a lot of e-sporting company. And in US, right, they watch sports. The first one is NFL, which is National Football League. The second is eSports, which a lot actually is owned by Tencent. So Tencent's big customers base is not just in China. It's in the US. They also own like all these Norton antivirus and maybe, okay, they have one more thing called cloud. But the cloud one, I don't know, in US, which one is the biggest? They also have JD. JD, they own 20%. So a lot of the revenue comes from JD also. But JD losing money now. But anyway, it's like the Amazon of China. Okay, the biggest competitor, of course, is Alibaba. But you must know, they are only, they one of their department fight with Alibaba. The rest, okay, Alibaba also come and fight back. Then they also own, what else? Like Yahoo. Hey, Yahoo, nobody wants really, correct? Now, if you read Yahoo News and stuff like that, right, it is like their QQ. I was trying to figure out what's QQ, but all the like financial sites and everything, right, they actually go to QQ to read on. Okay, they also own Uber. You know Uber, right? WeChat Pay, guess what? They also own, like, for example, Grab Pay. They own, like, it's a bit like PayPal, guys. No kidding, eh? Because let's say you want to do e-commerce, right? You want to do e-commerce, usually you will set up a PayPal link, then people can pay through there. In China, it will be WeChat Pay. WeChat Pay, or now I think Alipay is getting a bit more famous, catching up. Alipay is catching up. Okay, then the next one, this one, y'all guess what? They have entertainment. They have Tencent Music and stuff like that. You guess what is the equivalent? Y'all guess what is the equivalent?
Netflix.
Yeah. Actually, they didn't mention that it's like Netflix. They mentioned it's a bit more like Spotify. The music is much bigger. Hey, by the way, their user base in Tencent Music is more than Spotify. In case you all think that, they only like one, what, their one department can crush a lot of things, you know. Okay, and also social media, of course, their user about similar to Facebook, about a few billion. And then finally, like WhatsApp, or what do you call that, Line. Hey, you can see, you buy one stock, you buy all of this. Now, it's almost like an ETF, and they are diversifying so fast. And the cool thing about them is this, because why I say this company is super strong. Actually, you think about it, right? One company in US also want to be like them. Everything also pao ka liao. Everything also, is it an international crowd? Everything they also want to do, right? Which company on the screen right here on US, right? Everything they also want to do one. You make a guess? In fact, they changed their name already. They changed their name to represent that everything they also want.
Alphabet.
Tencent is Don't Play Pay, right? Yes, it's Alphabet. It's actually Google, like Alphabet. Not Amazon. Amazon also everything want to do, but they are not as aggressive as Google. So Google also want to fight in a lot of areas, but Google have not been successful. Like they try to fight, they have this Google Plus. They try to fight like Facebook a bit, cannot win. They try to fight here, try to fight that. Some things win a bit, some things lose a bit. But Tencent, when they go in, they crush one. I have not seen Tencent have very bad products yet. They have not had a lot of fit products. This is how powerful they are. So if they are coming after you, they have a high chance they will win because the ecosystem is so strong. And a lot of 1 billion people using Tencent already. So it's super powerful. Okay? So yep. I think there are some questions, right? Nancy is asking, and I think Aaron is also asking, Tencent, should you buy in US or China Stock Exchange? No. US or Hong Kong Stock Exchange. Correct.
Yeah.
Now, actually, you can buy in Hong Kong Stock Exchange for one reason. My only one reason is this, that if next time they give dividends, then you don't get taxed so much. Because when you actually buy in US, it is called ADR. Okay, then when they give dividends, Donald Trump or whoever the next guy is, or maybe Kanye West running for president, if y'all don't know who is he, so a singer want to be president, they will take 30% of our dividends. But I think right now, there isn't much chance they will actually do dividends play. Reason being, they are still expanding aggressively. Hey, but this Tencent holding, wow, when I see already, I don't know what about you guys. Your saliva dripping or not, you guys? What, do you think it's powerful, this company? Wow, Tencent, Tencent sounds like... sounds like a cheap company. I tell you, it's not. They earn 10 cents from everyone in the world. They make a lot of money. It's like everybody's, they say, like, people in China spit saliva at you, you drown already. Now they earn 10 cents from each China people every single day. Imagine, every day you own 10 cents, every second 10 cents is going into your bank account. Sounds very little, but it's coming in dripping. Yeah. Waterfall.
Waterfall.
Your saliva drip. Tsunami. Okay, steady. Yeah. Okay, sorry, Chloe. I hand it back to you. I just want to share the whole picture. By the way, most of it is presented by Chloe. When I saw the slides, I wanted to let... Because a lot of us don't know what all the companies we may not know, because we're not in China. But putting in perspective. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, so I think the amazing part about this company is, even though it has really been like the market leader for many areas, but it continued to innovate and continue to improve, and that's why it's only getting stronger. So for example, one of the initiatives that they are doing, I think they just launched it long 2 years ago, which is called a mini program. I'm not sure, some of you maybe the Tencent users, right? So once you start to have these mini programs, actually for my parents, they use Tencent a lot to connect with their relatives. So I realized that nowadays, every day they stay at home, they play the mini program, which can be games.
Your parents play the mini program?
Yeah, like they play Mahjong on Tencent every single day.
You talk. I can give you some effect, yeah.
And apart from, I mean, like, Mahjong is one of the game that, because as a app, you really want to retain people's attention. The more more time that the people use it, the more data that you gather, and it's definitely more valuable to the company. But at That's the same right. time, it has many other mini programs that you can directly shop through Tencent. So you don't need to, you can directly shop through WeChat. So you don't need to leave the app. And it's like really giving them so much data point, and each transaction that they actually make, right, through their mini program, they are actually taking a cut from all these merchants. So
Mahjong sound effect.
Yeah, really amazing.
Okay. Hey, by the way, this is one thing amazing about Tencent. If you all realize, right, most of the app, right, most of the social media app, at least you talk about, right, there's a certain target group they're targeting. For example, if you are a boomer, you want to use a boomer, I don't know, use what, but if let's say you use a certain app, Facebook, they say for slightly not Generation Z, strawberry generation or Generation Z, they don't want to use Facebook because their parents are on it. They will use Instagram, then they use TikTok. TikTok also China one, but it's not under Tencent. Now, but WeChat, they who cares? You old, you young, everything they also bao ka liao. They actually capture everyone, you know. This is something very amazing. But this is how they are able to expand. Amazing. Yep.
And even though, like, for example, if the youngsters may not be using WeChat actively, right, they are also using the other app called QQ. And QQ are very popular among youngsters. So they literally really capture the whole population of China inside their palm. Like, really amazing. So let's talk about delve into different key sectors so that all this information, right, can be actually found in the annual report, but I just want to highlight certain important portions for you to consider whether you want to understand this company a lot better before investing in this company. All right, so if you see, like, the daily messages, which is mainly through WeChat, it's up like 15% year on year. I think it's like really amazing. It just shows that not only it has a lot of people, like more than 1.2 billion people using it, the time usage is also increasing, and it's definitely giving a lot of advantage to Tencent itself. And apart from that, now since recently there's a coronavirus issue, they are also developing other things like Zoom, but they call it QQ. I think they call it like QQ Zoom or whatever. So this one, they have these school plus home groups that have more than 120 million users. So they are really facilitating a lot of different things. Like, remember the mini programs that I just mentioned, Can you see that in 2019 alone, the transaction generated through mini program is exceeding more than 800 billion renminbi.
I see the Zoom very funny. I can see the banana vester Ken Lim driving and listening to us. Hey, drive safe, are you? Okay. So. So you can see, technology is so powerful that people drive can still be connected. So you can see that nowadays we are all connected, and this particular WeChat or Tencent, right? They are the technology in China. They are really connecting everyone. And so the stickiness is too powerful. It's a business I cannot imagine going down. Like it's even corona proof.
Later, I'm going to show you data. It's corona proof. It's really like it's not impacted at all. Okay. So apart from that, there's also other sector, sector that they are focusing on as a company. So they are doing like a lot of games, and those games, right? These mobile games are not only popular in China. They are in fact gaining more popularity overseas as well. I'm not sure some of you maybe play these games before. Like, do you play PUBG, Sean?
I spend my time doing very, very, productive things. I play things like Crash Royale or Brawl stuff. This kind of game, violent one. I don't play this kind of one. I play QQ one. Okay, which, by the way, the games that I play are also owned by them. It's under Supercells, which actually Tencent is also one of the big shareholders. So a lot of games that you play, quite of them link back to Tencent one. Yeah.
Correct. I remember PUBG, right? It was actually introduced by my sister's friend to me. Okay, so like she was staying over in our house, and then she our age gap is like 10 years older. So even 10 years below
me. So your sister like about 30 plus now, is it?
No lah.
I'm just kidding. Okay, never mind. So then
my sister is like in her 20s, like early 20s. So her friends are also in her early 20s. So they are really playing PUBG and these kind of games made by Tencent. And I just want to show you that growth rate that international games that
crazy.
Tencent is conquering the market. It's like 23% of the online game revenue and international games revenue are double year on year. Doubling year on year. Can you see how aggressive is the market share being overtaken by Tencent? And then at the end of the 2019, right? 5 out of top 10 most popular smartphone games are actually developed by Tencent. So so if you are smartphone game users, you can type down some of the names here. You never know, actually you go and find later, right? Actually it belongs to Tencent. So whenever you play, whenever you decide to buy something, you are contributing to revenue of Tencent as well.
Yeah, even Activision Blizzard, right? Some of their competitors, Tencent also one of the big investors. It's like crazy. You can't avoid them, you know. But this is how beautiful Tencent is, you know. I mean, their whole entire management, right? They are super open to investing in their competitors. Say we fund you, lah. It's okay, if you win us, we also win, ma. So their mindset is like a bit unheard of, lah. But I think nowadays the world is getting like that. But Tencent is not the first few that really go all out, try to kill themselves, invest in their competitors and things like that. Amazing. Some question they're asking is, they are concerned about the Hong Kong Stock Exchange given the political situation. Now, I don't think anything's going to change. Anyway, you all must understand something. Even if, let's say, the stocks in the stock exchange, let's say the stock exchange collapse for any reason, which so far I've never unheard of. I mean, stock market crash, but the exchange, let's say, no longer can actually... Okay, you must understand something. What is an exchange? Exchange is like an eBay. Do you all use eBay or auction sites? If you use eBay auction sites, please type auction or please type eBay. The stock exchange is just a site for you to buy and sell things. You know, that's all. If the auction exchange gone, the stock exchange gone, correct? It's like basically eBay gone. But can you still let's say the laptop that you buy from eBay, is it still a laptop? The answer is yes. But can you go back to the eBay to sell? The answer is no. A bit more difficult. But as a listed company, when the stock exchange closed down, they will go and put in other stock exchange. So don't need to worry too much. They will just facilitate the selling and buying of stocks from somewhere else. But you will be a shareholder. You are a legit shareholder of Tencent. You know, the best is actually if the stock exchange closed down, even better. Because Warren Buffett said this. He said that he wants to buy stocks, right? That even if the exchange, the stock market closed for the next 10 years, he also don't care. In fact, no exchange, maybe you will keep longer, you'll make more money. No? So this is the thing. Who start to share screen?
Ria Ara, are you able to stop your share screen?
Yes, Tencent do not have options in US also.
Correct.
Right. I personally think it's quite safe. Okay, no need to worry too much about the exchange. Hopefully, yeah. Because it is listed there, the price drop. Then you can go in. Yep.
So, Ria Ara, are you able to stop? Thanks. Yeah, so some of you may be wondering, like, hey, so how are you going to buy from Hong Kong Stock Exchange? I think one way is if you use Interactive Broker, you can actually use it to buy overseas exchange like Hong Kong. Alternatively, you can also use local broker where they actually get the shares for you on behalf. Like, that is also possible. Yeah.
Expensive. If you go and use, like, let's say you're from Singapore, from Malaysia, you use your local broker, go and buy Hong Kong stocks. I can tell you it's very expensive. The brokerage is more expensive and every month you have to pay some fee. So you can use Saxo Capital or you can use Interactive Broker. TD, right. Ameritrade, Trade or Think or Swim, you can't really do that.
Yep, TD, you can't buy Hong Kong shares. You can only buy US shares, all right?
So That's right.
That is for the online game just now. So another sector that they are really putting a lot of investment on and they are just going to grow even bigger is actually fintech. So like what Sean mentioned earlier, there is like this payment function that Tencent actually does transaction and accept and transfer money and everything, right? This is their key focus. And in fact, they're also making a pretty decent income from these fintech. So in the fourth quarter of 2019, they exceed every day 1 billion transaction on their commercial platform. Okay, so it's like WeChat Pay or, you know, like now Chinese New Year, right? I think Singapore is also picking up the trend. Instead of really giving ang bao, you are through PayNow, yeah. PayLa, right? So what?
QR code.
QR code. In China, it's directly sent to your wallet inside WeChat. You don't even need to go through everything. And they package it so nice that it's already like an ang bao. So it's like really amazing. And they started it a few years ago. And Singapore only started it like this year or last year. But they started way longer. And it's really like China is really growing much faster actually compared to the rest of the world in terms of all this digitalization. Right. So, and they are also coming up with another platform. They are fighting with Alibaba. Okay. So this platform is called Li Cai Tong. So with Li Cai Tong, right, people can actually invest in
Someone mentioned cannot already. Now they must do KYC to do the ang bao because maybe of anti-money laundering. Okay. Actually you're right. So you see Tencent, right? Because they are in this space, they also garner a lot of regulation one. But well, so far so good. Sorry, continue. Hey, Chloe, I think I'm muted. I'm muted already.
Can hear? So regulation is definitely one of the risks which we will talk about it more during later on. So another thing that they are coming up is this Li Cai Tong, where they are really trying to fight with another service that Alibaba provide, which is investing in some short-term funds or short-term like bonds and all this, and you know, like doing micro loans and everything that can help them to make much more interest income and everything. So, and with the app being so predominant to every user, right, it's so easy to actually start your own small investment using the Cai Tong as well. So yeah, that's a advantage that they're having. And another thing which is Sean also mentioned earlier, they are also going very big in cloud, okay? Cloud and other business services. So their cloud service actually exceed like 17 billion in 2019, and they are constantly outgrowing the market. And this is something that I'm as a shareholder, I'm very pleased to see that, because we know that the cloud is the future. Okay, if you do agree that cloud, it's really like the future, please type cloud. Okay. And actually Baba and Tencent, they are also going very heavy in this technology as well to see who can be the leader. So I think so far it's still Baba being a leader, but Tencent is also doing a lot to catch up. Okay, and they are also adopting a lot of cloud-based solutions for long-term to facilitate remote working, remote interaction, so that to suit our habit change, potential habit change due to COVID-19 situations as well.
Oh, they mentioned this question. I think it's very interesting. Is it very dangerous? So Aaron, good question. Is it very dangerous? As Tencent has a lot of customers in US, given the relationship of US and China. Okay, very interestingly, how Tencent actually have customers in China is over the internet. It's not like direct over like a cross-border transaction. So that a lot of customers in China, in US, right, is esports. Ma. Esports, actually, everything is through internet already. So this is something, it's not like Huawei. Huawei, you have to deliver the phone, right? And you need certain parts. Esports-wise, I don't think it'll be affected. And most of the way they're actually making money also is through investments, through other, like I would say, esports companies. So, I mean, unless US block the investments, but so far there isn't any indication of that. I think it's a very good question, actually. But don't see any problem. US government is not the main issue. It's the Chinese government that is the issue. Because whenever a company is becoming so powerful, it affects the whole entire nation, maybe the government will start to be like watching you everything that you do. Like Facebook, like, every time Ghana call for go and meet the senators and have to go and talk to the Congress and say what happened to all your data protection and stuff like that. Huh? So far, so good. Okay?
Yep. So now let's take a look at like how much impact has COVID actually brought to Tencent, this business. Okay. let's do a comparison between last year and this year. Okay, from there we can
this quarter one only, right? This quarter one, correct. So yeah, quarter two, I think, is in August. August they will be announcing. Yeah, hopefully they disappoint the market and the price goes down. Okay, I got a strong feeling it won't. Okay. But let's see.
So you can see that the percentage of like increment, okay, from like let's talk about VAS, which is value added services, including online gaming, including subscription. Like remember, it also has this Shopee, Spotify portion. It also kind of have this Netflix portion, right? So there's a lot of subscription for their video content, for their music content. So
people ask me to put they're asking me to actually make sound effect. Okay, later I'll make some sound effect. Okay, continue talking. I will make.
Yeah, so the revenue continue to increase. And for fintech and business services, like payment, like investment, like cloud, right? Also, the increase is really huge. More than...
Yeah, of course.
20% jump. Then online advertising... Yeah. Because Tencent, they actually like using WeChat and using a lot of different websites that they have, right? Advertisers can go and advertise, and they also continue to make more money using advertisement as well. So the others, I think you can ignore, but the main three bulk.
Why ignore? Oh yeah, others very small, 2%.
Yeah, very small.
But even the others are small. Oh yeah, one thing that's very powerful about Tencent, right? Whenever they see certain places making more money, they pour more focus into it. So that they are known to be doing that. So they do a review of. Or which one making more money, boom, then the margins is higher, they will shift into it. So they are very good at making money, they are very good at making copying people's ideas, but they really do very well. So whether you like it, don't like it, they are very powerful.
And they improve on their people's idea actually, and that's how they become stronger as well. Yeah. And if you look at the next thing, let's look at Morningstar. The revenue growth is tremendous over the years. Yep. Okay, EPS also jumped like don't know how many times since 2010. And free cash flow is always very strong. So it's a very cash rich company. And they always
Kenim, drive your car, drive Kenim. You don't look at the screen. Later you look. I see him driving and looking at the screen. Hey. Later I make the sound effect for you. Don't okay. Yeah.
So for Tencent, they do pay out dividend, but it's very minimal amount. So you can see the payout ratio is like about 10%. So they still retain 90% of their earnings, right? Really for expansion to continue to do R&D and business expansion. Right? In terms of the net margin, it's super healthy in their 25% range, and interest coverage is also like many, many times. So this company is definitely like you don't really need to worry too much that it's having a lot of debt. In fact, the income is more than enough to cover 15 years of interest, right? So one thing I want to share, like which is very interesting, is because in the annual report, they will also highlight exactly when they will actually do stocks buyback. And from there, you can actually see what is the price that the company think is a reasonable price to acquire back the shares, okay, some of them. So this is a price range about 320 to 350 in between last year. So this is written in the annual report. So if you look at this, and if you see that if the stock price managed to drop to this range, actually you are basically buying, you're paying the same price as the company confidence level. Because the company must be confident to buy at this price. They believe that the stock price will continue to grow more, and that's why they are willing to invest in this amount. So if you are able to catch this opportunity, then it's fantastic, right? So that's
You're talking about the price now, is it? The price now is 300 plus.
The price now is 500 plus already.
Then you talk what?
March,
okay,
right,
waste our time.
In March, it dropped to 300 plus. And that's
but they
went
in March lah. They went in March man. Now it's what in March the police wear shorts lah.
I just want to share. It's a very good habit to also keep track of the company's annual report and see what is the price range that they are targeting.
They want to support. They want to support that level.
Yeah, you can set alert, right? Mm. So this is what I did, and that's why I managed to buy around this price range during March. Okay, so yeah, right? So one thing that I also want to highlight about Ma Hua Teng is he's a founder. Okay, he's a founder of this company, and if you are having a founder to run a company, right? Definitely, this founder is firstly vision driven as well, and secondly, he really want the company, the business, to do well because this is his baby. And the percentage of shareholding that he's having is 8.5%, which is considered a very huge amount of shareholding compared to other mini investors. So his interests are definitely in line with shareholders like you and me. So when you are investing in companies like these, founder-led companies generally perform better. Actually, statistics have shown founder-led companies generally perform better than other companies that are just hired CEO and hired chairman.
That's right. Okay, so one thing interesting, I think he owned about 8.something% only, So he's not the biggest shareholder. The biggest shareholder is another company. I can't remember, but he's not the biggest shareholder. So what it also means is this, he doesn't have the controlling rights because there are some cock shareholders. Okay, so I know some people, am I still there?
Yeah, you are there.
Oh, like some people, I know you all love Elon Musk a lot, but Elon Musk, I think he has much more holdings. He can actually trigger a buyout and stuff like that. But in this case, Tencent, there's no way you can do that. So far, so good.
So far, so good. But I think 8% to 10% is considered a relatively huge stake. Because that's how your portfolio...
Warren Buffett, Steve Jobs, all around there. But you look at Asia, you won't see this kind of things on. Asia, they want to hold 20, 30, add up together, they and their family add up together 50%. So that they make sure anything wrong, I can vote the rest of the people. But in US or in other parts of the world, not that much. Okay, it's quite interesting.
Yep. So the next thing we want to see is the impact of COVID-19. Just now we saw 2018 and 2019 that increased the increment, right? Let's take a look at quarter by quarter, actually Q1 of 2020. So if we compare Q1 of 2019 and Q1 of 2020, that is right. The percentage change. Like year on year, value added services continue to increase by 27.5%. Okay, online gaming is really strong. Social network is really strong. Online advertisement also grew by 30%. Okay, and fintech wise, right, also grew by 20%. So you can see that it has almost minimal impact, even despite of COVID-19.
Right. Yeah. In fact, it helps them lah. It helps them because they're online mah. Their delivery don't have any physical one. Not that I know of. Okay, all of them is online. So. Yeah, lor. Imagine all the tech companies is improving, right? They improve together as well, lor.
Yeah. So that's why when we come to, hey, if we understand this is a very wonderful companies that like solid foundation, solid management as well. So like if 4 months up, 55% gain, so exactly, is this the right time to sell? Actually, what do you think, Sean?
Actually, right now, right, if you look at valuation, there are a few ways to look at it. Yeah. So we are diving into valuation right now, is it? Okay, maybe you share your portion first, then after I share a few ways to look at it. Yeah.
So maybe I share from my point of view in terms of the valuation first. So you can see, if you go to Morningstar, you can actually also compare the current P/E ratio with the 5-year average P/E ratio. This is, I think, I screenshot it about a few days ago, so it shouldn't change that much. Okay? So, P/E ratio...
It changed a bit already. Maybe I share mine.
I let you share.
Yeah, because I think the price dropped recently, so that's where it looks a bit different.
Okay,
here. Can see, So, this is the latest, fresh from the oven.
Yeah, slightly different.
17 July, which is Friday. So what I personally like to take a look at is the... did you change? Yeah, change right,
From
numbers?
49 to 48, yeah.
49 to 48. Okay, so I like to look at 5 years. Now, because you will know that... Okay, what is P/E ratio for those who are new? Basically, it's how many times you are paying for the amount that they are making. So, P/E ratio, right, you can see average on average past... we look at 5 years. 5 years is a good benchmark. because too long ago, they are a slightly different company. Now they are a bit more famous already. So last time you can see 20 plus. You can see right here, 2010 to 2012, not many people know about Tencent Holdings one. You go and check YouTube, you go and find, don't have one. Okay, 2013 onwards, they become quite famous. And then you can see people pay roughly about 40 plus. So 5 years average about 42. Right now it's 48. Definitely it's on the high side, correct? Mm. So if you ask me whether I will buy right now, my answer is I won't buy. Okay. Now, one thing that I also like to take a look right now is like, well, but you see, there may be an opportunity to buy. Let me tell you why. After I actually did a tech workshop, I mean, for those who are not in the NS group, we are going to conduct another workshop. I mean, for those who have attended a tech workshop and you enjoy it, you want more workshop, can you all please type workshop or type more? Then we know that you all appreciate, then we will do lah. Otherwise, sekali next time we run, nobody do, right? So now, just type on the chat group that you all want more of it.
Now, a lot of people say more workshop.
Yeah. Because actually, we enjoy it a lot, you know. What happened is, when I deep dive, right, I realized that the book value, price to book value, right, may be a better indicator. So based on price to book value, the 5 years average is 10. Then now it's 9.8 something. So it's slightly undervalued based on the book value. And I feel that the book value, to me, I begin to realize that book value increased steadily over the years. So it reflects a company's value steadily. Where else, like, sometimes I make a lot, next year I suddenly drop because of one-time earnings, one-time project and things. But the book value builds up. So if I use price to book, it's more stable entry. Now, based on price to book, right, maybe right now is also an okay time to invest a bit, you know. Yep, not extremely a lot. If it's 7 points, you can see, like, if you invest here, then better deal, right? Mm-hmm. So just now, who is it that mentioned? Wei Jie said that he believes that the stock price will drop, right? Okay? I do hope that you're right, because, well, you know, once you're a listed company, there'll be good news, there'll be bad news, there'll be good news, there'll be bad news. So it's just hoping for more good news along the way. But if you're very good, there'll be more good news, ma. Just like your employer, your employee, okay, you do work, you're very hardworking, you always perform. So there will be more chance of you getting promoted, lah. But will there be bad days? Will there be like some days you fail in a project and then you kind of scolded? Answer is yes. So we want to actually invest when those times comes, right? But right now, doesn't seem too expensive, you know. Right now seems too quite okay. And remember, this company, right, is not slowing down. Now, maybe I use another method. I like to use another method called discounted cash flow. So this is Guru Focus. It's a free website. You don't have to pay for it. You can click on discounted cash flow. And we just need to understand a few things. So this one is in US. US one, right?
Mm.
Now, you all can see this. So right now, the EPS is 1.4 based on US. Okay, based on US. The stock price is 67. Preferably don't look at the stock price. Preferably, okay? Now, let me ask you guys. We do this together collectively so that you come out with a valuation using DCF. DCF is we project how much money they can make us, and that's why they are worth this amount, okay? So now, next 10 years, what is the percentage you all think Tencent can grow? Okay, you all type a number. Is it 10%, 20%? But before you type, let me show you. This is the past 10 years, EPS, okay, EPS, okay. It's actually a conservative way of looking at EPS. It has been growing past 10 years at 33%, past 5 years at 31%. The last year, it was 8.4. So, I will ask you guys to avoid looking at 1 year. 1 year is very subjective. 1 year is very subjective, okay? So don't look at 1 year. Look at 10 years, 5 years. You can see, is it slowing down a bit? Okay, now we look at the book value. Book value past 10 years is 40. Past 5 years is 36. Maybe it's slightly slowed down. But what about the next 10 years? What is a good and fair number to give it? What do y'all think? You want to put what? It can drive, lah. Can drive. You show me the sign. Don't type. 20%, 30%, okay? Okay, okay, what do y'all think? 20, 30, a lot of 20, 30. Okay, it's up to you guys. Up to you guys. Some people say 15. Okay, this will affect whether... So it depends on how much you believe in the company. This part is subjective, but at least you look at the benchmark past 5 years, 10 years. Okay, so y'all must think of one thing. Don't just look at data. Look at the company. What else do they have? They have gaming. Gaming is increasing a lot. It's increasing very fast. And they have, of course, a lot of other things. Payment, fintech. So do you think it is going to slow down? That's the question. That's the question. Okay. So obviously, the way I ask the question affect how you think. But okay. So some people say Tencent become $1. Already become $1 billion already, brother. Okay. So we see. So you all say 20. Is it most people put 20?
Yeah.
You put 20. Put 20. Okay. So what you do is this, at the growth stage for the next 10 years, I'm going to put 20 now. So I change to 20. Now, after 10 years, this is how fund managers and investors will take a look. So we say, okay, they grow 20% at 10 years. Then after 10 years, what's going to happen? Do you think they can continue to grow after 10 years? After 10 years, so 11 to 20 years, definitely slow down. But how much can they grow? You tell me. For the okay, we know that they can survive for a very long one. I don't think they will only survive for 20 years, but we want to have a certain stage to calculate. So tell me right now, 11 to 20 years, instead of 20%, they will drop to how much? Drop to 15. Wow, serious, still so fast. Okay, okay, I'm going to put 15. You all say one. Okay, 15. But I think for a company like Tencent, I saw somebody put 10. I'm very kiasu one, so I put a lower one.
More conservative.
More conservative, Okay. So this is the amount. This is the amount. Okay, I haven't calculated for you guys. Now the last thing I want to ask you is this. What is a good when they say discount rate, it means how much money you want to make. Every year you want to make how many percent? 15%, 10%. Of course, everybody want to make 100%. But if you put 100%, I tell you in the end, the calculator will show you cannot buy anything. Okay. So what is a good percentage you want to buy? You want to get 10%. Okay. Oh, hey, okay, 10%. Can. Let me put 10%. So little. Okay, lah. Okay. I'm going to put there, 10%. 10%. Okay, nah, you all say, 10%. And then that's where. Wait. Hey, how come the number come out? Did I type something wrong? Oh, okay, wait. So growth rate is 10%, correct?
Yeah. 10. Yeah.
11, 10. Okay, 10. Oh, eh? How come the cannot grow at 10 years at 10? Okay, I'm gonna put 10.5. Let's see what happens. Okay, so the fair value, guys, ladies and gentlemen, based on the collective wisdom of everybody on this Saturday afternoon, the fair value is 57. 57, So now the stock price is 67. So what should you do? No, that's why you shouldn't look at the calculator as you adjust. I tell you, I see a lot of students that I teach before, their hand will be itchy. They say, actually, now that I think of it, reasonably, right? Tencent holding should be go at 31. Should I go at 30? Cannot be 20. Okay, then they adjust 31. Fair value 100 plus. Can buy. Don't do that. So independently, go and do your adjustment. And then after that, go and tell yourself whether you can invest or not. Okay, personally, maybe I share with you what I think. Personally, let's take a look at it. Personally, my discount rate, how much I want to make, at least 15%. 10%, then I think can make more. Don't need to put so little. Then for the next 10 years, I think Tencent can grow at 30%. I think it can grow at 30%. And then the growth rate, after 10 years, because 10 years later from 11 to 20 is a bit far away. So I want to be a little bit more conservative. I'm going to put, let's say, 5%. 4 to 5%, because maybe they're so big already. They are so big until they grow at maybe inflation rate, roughly around there. Inflation rate. So how much is this? Oh, 59. Still cannot buy. So suck time lah. Sorry, guys. Based on what we say right now, okay lah. This is how you calculate lah. Don't rush. I want to say don't rush. I really very generous. I give them 30% growth for you. So don't rush. Now is not the best time to buy. PE ratio say don't buy. PB say around there. So you give it a bit more time, wait for it to hit maybe at least 59, then you buy at a fair value. Buy a good company at a fair value, that's where it's okay. Then, Chloe, you all waste my time. This kind of stock, I cannot invest. My Saturday afternoon, I want to know how to make money. So you tell me cannot make, then how?
Waste okay, my time. Okay. Later, I share with you how to make money, okay? But do you guys think, if it's not undervalued, it's good to wait. Some people say sell put, right? Don't have US don't have option for
Hong Kong may have
Hong Kong have yeah if you have a brokerage account in like IB or Sasso, I'm not too sure, but
Sasso, I think
you can have options for Tencent as well.
Yeah.
These are our options students, so that's why they are very hot towards options. So yeah, so that's for but like in terms of selling, do you think it's time to sell?
No need. I don't think it's super overpriced. Yeah. But I like to take some profits. So very simple. If you think it's overpriced by a certain percent, take a certain percent. Take away some of the profit. So in case it drops, then you can pump back in. Then you will lose. So you feel that if it's 10% overvalued now, right? Or slightly overvalued, right? Then you sell off 10% of the stocks. Something like that as a benchmark. The thing is to keep yourself active in terms of Actually, I ask you to sell, don't sell, right? I believe 5-10 years later, right, it will still be making a lot of money. The reason why maybe you want to sell a bit, it is to manage your own expectation and your own anxiety.
Emotions, yeah.
So if you can relax, do it, then you'll be okay. Cool?
actually, I totally agree on that. I'm not going to sell my stocks away because firstly, if you see how the stock price has transformed over the years, if you make 50%, you decide to sell, then there will be, you will never be able to captivate the true stock price gain for this company. Like, it's like, don't know how many times over, like literally like 5,000 beggars a kind of return. So in my opinion, it's like, if it's a good company and the fundamentally is still very sound, the value is not too overvalued, I think it's still reasonable, you should just keep it. In my opinion, I will just keep it. I will just continue to let the profit run. And if there's dip, I will actually buy more so that I have more stake in this company. All right. So
I just checked. So if you use Saxo Capital, you can sell Tencent Holdings Hong Kong put. You can do that, but you must calculate Hong Kong price. You can calculate US price. So Tencent Holdings, the ticker symbol 007 something. Let me see.
Yeah, 0700.
Oh, 700. Yeah. Oh, 700. Yeah, yeah. Tencent Holdings. You can use Saxo Capital. Get some money, sell some puts.
Okay, so there are also some risks to consider as an investor. So some of them is like you have to consider regulatory risks because in China, definitely regulation.
Online gaming. There was a point in time. You saw the government, you saw the stock price drop a lot, right? Because they hit on hard on online gaming. I hope they do it one more time. Okay, yeah. But you know people cannot stop them from online gaming. It's not really totally illegal and stuff like that. So it's very difficult. Maybe certain kind of games they can restrict. So let's go and complain. Ask all your China relatives, go and complain. Chloe, you got some people in China, you know, right? Go and complain, say that play too much games. Then government will, during election, say, oh, stop gaming. Then the price drop, then we buy. Okay?
Voila. Okay, another risk to consider is R&D risk. Definitely, it has continued to invest in R&D to evolve so that the platform and everything is even better, serve the people even better. And of course, there's also data protection risk, some information risk. So, these are some, then if there's any breach of such news, it could be a good time to enter because when everybody is fearful, I don't think fundamentally it won't change the economy more of Tencent. So if there's such bad news, actually it's a very good
time. So far don't have that. So far Tencent don't have this kind of issue. And then the only kind of lawsuits they get into is anti-monopoly because they're too big, antitrust. So it's like you're too big, then people will complain. So they purposely let the TikTok run. They let the TikTok run, then say, that one is a competitor. But after that, they also go and sue TikTok. Okay, so they are having a lawsuit with TikTok. Hopefully TikTok win the lawsuit, hit back into Tencent, then Tencent lose some reputation, then we can go in. I'm hoping they cannot. Yeah, it's very funny. As a shareholder, we hope that they get no bad news.
Yeah.
A bit weird. Okay, everybody happy, but hopefully there's a good time to buy. Yeah.
That's why being a contrarian investor, we call it ourselves like contrarian. When people are greedy, we be fearful. When people are fearful, we be greedy. All right. So just now, Sean actually asked, Chloe, this one cannot buy one. How to make money? Okay. So there are some ways that we can also share with you guys to actually exactly how you can make more income, generate more income to fund your investment. Okay. Let's swim in the sea. The ocean of abundance, right? Exactly how to generate cash, and I think Sean he has some tips to share along the way as well.
I see some of their comment very funny. Seldrick say, why is the ticker 700 when it's only 10 cents? Then what should be what? Then I don't know lah. So I don't know what to say. Price target 700. Hey, well, you all can read data into anything, man. Now the price target should go up to 700. I don't know lah. This one. Okay,
not
so
bad, not bad. Price target 700, not bad.
Or invest safely and profitably. Yes.
I think the first one is because it's so the economy situation. Actually, you've been talking about it again and again. The data is not showing that the economy is doing well yet. The stock market, especially the U.S. market, going up and up. I think in this period of time, you really have to be more conservative in terms of how we invest. So for yourself, how much cash position are you holding on right now, actually?
I'm distracted by the chat. Comment. So Ken is home. Everybody very happy that he has safely arrived home. So you see, I think it's a very good analogy in a sense. When you are driving, it can be very risky. It can be very safe, right? Right now, it is like you are driving on a road that is not very... The foundation is not there. I don't know whether you know Singapore, Nikko Highway, it collapsed, right? I feel that the stock market right now, if you invest right now, you're riding on a trend that may collapse because the foundation is not strong. Well, they are building the foundation in terms of the economy, trying to support the stock price, but I feel that right now it is not very safe. So instead of driving a very heavy car, okay, when I say heavy car, means you put in a lot of capital, right? You ride bicycle or motorbike. What's the faster one? Or you fly drone. You can still go and see the place, but you don't need to go and get into the danger, you know? So that's the thing. So using options, it is a vehicle. Now, stocks is a vehicle to get you rich. You buy Tencent Holdings, you buy Alibaba, you buy like Facebook, you buy, recently you're talking about McDonald's and EMC, correct? Buy all these companies that every day make money, right? You're becoming richer, correct? But however, now the stock price is at a high side. So if you go and buy now, there may be a certain risk where short-term wise, it may drop and then you feel very lousy. You feel like, oh, shucks, stock market cheat my money. Okay, stock market never cheat your money. It's basically the stock price drop because it will go up and down anyway. But if you give yourself time, right, you will make money. However, to risk yourself losing a lot of money, swinging up and down, you use options. Options, it is another vehicle. It's like a, okay, maybe when you talk about car, right? It's like a, okay, my analogies may be quite lousy. Plastic car, not so heavy on. Or carbon fiber car. Something that is very light, so that even when it crashes, right, the whole thing doesn't crash along with it. It can still float a bit, you know. You don't have to put in a lot of capital. This one thing I like about options. How many of you actually done options before? If you've done options before and you understand how powerful it is, right, can you please type options or type like what is your favorite option strategy? Because you got a lot of option strategy, right? BOSS, strategy X. For me, so Doris say yes, she's very thankful she earned from options. I can share with you, now the market is going up. So use stocks, use options, you also can make, options will make more, okay? Because you put in less, you earn more. This is the funny thing about options. So a lot of people actually do options, right? You know, a lot of favorite option strategy.
And that's why, like, when we're discussing about like the percentage of cash allocation, right? Actually, your cash allocation portfolio is relatively small. You still have, you have 70% cash and like 30% in investing right now. But because your 30% is mainly in options, right? That's like almost 100% of a normal person's portfolio compared to the person just buying stocks. Because when you buy stocks, you are using the heavy vehicles. If the stock price go against you, then that's how you suffer more capital loss. But if you are using options, if you do it safely and you know how to do it, actually your portfolio growth is optimized. And at the same time, the risk is also reduced. So I think it's something amazing. So another way that apart from investing, apart from using options, then you can consider, hey, maybe you can start your own online business because through starting a business. Hey, you know, recently I read about, you know, like Warren Buffett. And in the past, I always have this misconception that, hey, Warren Buffett really earned his wealth through investing, like pure investing. But after I start reading much, much deeper, right, I realized that actually his wealth is accumulated through both business and investing. If he doesn't do business, there is no way that he will become the Warren Buffett he is today. Because the amount that he invests in business, the cash that he generates using business, he funds his investment. And that's how he really compounded so well. So like business and investing is two powerful vehicles that I felt like we should all learn. And that's what Sean has been doing all this while actually, right?
Business-wise, right, I also begin to understand that their business are not all equal. So there are some businesses that's capital heavy, intensive, and right now those capital intensive businesses they are suffering. I actually feel very sad because I was actually talking to some of my friends. They actually do sell certain products and things like that, or they have certain like restaurant business really suffer. So and one of them, they are like he was making millions on, you know. Then suddenly overnight, because you know, especially if they actually own a building, they have huge renter. Suddenly he come and ask me for help also, and then I also thinking how to help him. So it's about digitalizing. So one simple way is actually now we do know Tencent, how they make money. They provide a lot of online services. That's where it can go very fast. So it's very COVID proof also. So for me, the reason why I do business, I can share with you something. I feel that business is a bit different from investing. Business is a bit like you join the voice, right? All those singing competition. So investing is like I'm the judge. I sit down there, then your singing sucks. I don't want you. Then ding, I want you, correct? Huh? You know what I'm saying? Oh?
Yeah,
Shark Tank. Shark Tank or people singing, right? Then I will say, no, I don't want to choose you. But now, so investing is you choose which business you want to come into a portfolio. But when you go and do a business yourself, it is you are the singer, you know. You go out there, then now the customers will judge you. So this is a very interesting skill set. But however, you all think about it, who actually make more money? Is it the judge or is it the singer? Is it the investor make more money or the business owner make more money? Well, the business owner, actually, they do make more money because they contribute the ideas and they also take on a lot of like the work themselves. So business does need a bit of work. We do our online education, all that. Frankly speaking, I was very glad lah, because you know now, although I invest about 30% of my portfolio, the market swings up and down. We still make some income using money, but we do have our online courses and things like that. So we still make money together. So think of the thing, how to actually have both streams of income, multiple streams of income, and also, yeah, can you all type multiple streams of income or passive income? Think of different ways lah. Otherwise, one method get cut off, right? Well, I feel sad for really some of my friends, you know. So those who know investing, they are still like surviving, okay. But the market becomes choppy, they also become a bit, how to say, when their business is affected.
You really feel on the edge, right? You don't really have other source of passive income when your investment may not be doing well all the time. Then you feel like, you really feel uneasy.
That's right. Oh, is there any ETF in US that has stake in Tencent and Alibaba? Actually, have. It's called ARK, A-R-K. Is it ARK? Let me just, ARKF.
You want to share screen?
No need. I just put inside the chat for them. Okay. So you can have this. Okay. This one actually I think have both Tencent, Alibaba, but it's there's a lot of other things. They do not focus on China tech. Okay. So I want to share that really having multiple streams. Oh, by the way, why did I actually want to do business and all that? Many, many years ago when I started investing, right, I realized, wow, investing very shock. I'm the judge, huh? So I say, oh, this business, Nike is good. I buy Nike. Then every day people buy the Nike shoes. I just sit back, relax, see the stock price goes up. I mean, not every day. I won't say every day. But we do know that when you buy, accumulate a lot of stocks using options, using stocks, right, your wealth increases. But if your capital is small, no matter how you increase, like 100% increase sounds a lot, right? But you only got $500, increase 100% is like $500. You become $1,000. It's like, so in order to become wealthier, you got to build more wealth. Got to employ more capital. Capital is powerful, okay? So capital is actually important. Yeah, Ark's biggest holding is Tesla.
That's right. Really, Warren Buffett grew his wealth because he really allocated so much of his cash from business to investment. So that's why, if you know how to generate multiple streams of income, and that stream of income, right, that passive income become your source of investment fund, that's how, if you have higher ROI, then you can grow much, much stronger. The portfolio will snowball much faster as well. If you guys enjoyed this session so far, please, or find it useful, please type useful. Then we will conduct more sessions like this to share with you more investment ideas and more income ideas along the way. And one more way that actually Sean, he also personally used to do, okay, now he doesn't do that much now, but he also do affiliating, right? So can you share with us how you started your affiliating journey last time?
Wait a minute. I just see some people admitting and I saw some chat. Any Singapore ETF, is it? Any SG ETF? As in, you want to buy Singapore ETF? This one is to buy, EWS is to buy Singapore as a whole. So this one is one. If listed in Singapore, preferably, it's not as effective. Okay? Hey, this one very funny one. So I was looking through, because, but by the way, I think really thank Chloe for hosting this session. So I enjoy this session a lot because I don't need to do much work. She already do all the homework. Then after that, I just have to come in and then share some of my ideas. So please also thank Chloe. Please show appreciation.
I really learned a lot. I learned from everyone as well. The ETF is a great idea.
Sick ETF. Sick ETF.
S-I-C-K.
No. Yeah, talking about that ETF is sick, right? Okay, so just give Chloe a thumbs up. Okay, now I want to share. This is very funny. When I saw this slide, right? I think I mentioned to Chloe they all before, but maybe they cannot remember totally. You know, last time I also want to make money to actually put more money in the stock market. By that time I was still working, so I got salary, but I also want to make extra income. So very funny one. I actually go and learn how to do like online business and all that. But you know it's not so straightforward one, not so straightforward. Then got one portion, right? They talk about affiliate link. You all heard about affiliate or not? If you heard about affiliate, please type A. Okay. Now affiliate link is basically, you don't need to create your own products, nothing lah. You just refer people lah, 介绍. So you go and recommend, hey, this one very good, very good. Then people buy, then you get some money. So that time, I tell you very funny. I actually learned about this affiliate link, right, through a program by Adam Koo. Have you heard of Adam Koo before?
Yep.
Adam Koo. Okay. So he actually talked about affiliate link. Then he talked about, hey, you can affiliate my products. So I go and sign up for affiliate link. I took the link and then I put inside a forum. Last time we had Facebook, right? Last time, my era. Oh, it means, anyway, I'm 39 years old. So my era don't have Facebook yet. I go and post it in forum. Then next day, I saw email in my Hotmail, then I use Hotmail. Hey, my PayPal suddenly got money, you know. I said, click bank. The PayPal suddenly got money. I make about, if I remember correctly, about $200, you know, USD. Then I go and check. Then I realized people at the forum, they click on my affiliate link, then I make money. So I got very excited. I want to go back to the forum and then tell them more. Like, I want to post in more. You know, forum last time, do you all remember the days of forum? If you remember the days of forum, you go into forum, right? Can you please type F for forum? Then they have different topics. So I want to go to every topic and share with them the link. Very funny. Yeah, I want to spam the forum so that more people click on my link and they buy, then I make money. Because $200, not bad. Free money, right? I mean, okay, not say free. But when I go there, I realize I cannot log into the forum because they banned me. I'm not supposed to sell things in the forum one. Then I didn't know that. So after that, right, I'm thinking that, but I look at the money, I say it's real money. And then I didn't think much work. I just, Adam Koo is the one, he has a reputation and he sells and good lah. Then after that, right, I actually went to create a blog spot. You know blog, don't know whether, okay, I'm using a very old terms lah, ICQ, blog spot, forum. Then my blog spot, right, is now no longer there lah. But what happened is, I created a blog spot. Then I talk about Adam Koo. Then I write in a very controversial way. I say, well, this guy, you all must be careful of him. Okay. So when I feel that when I write something in a more controversial way, people will read. So after I write, well, Adam Koo, you all be careful of him. Because he will teach you how to become rich. Then after that, right, when you become rich, you'll become evil. I mean, those kind of funny things. You know, I write in a very funny way. Then after that, right, nobody come to my blog spot. Then I realize, how come I didn't want? Then I take my link. I go to Adam Koo's blog and I post in a comment. So when I post in the comment, right, a lot of people read, you know, suddenly, guess 1 week, right, I make how much money? Y'all just make a guess, my first affiliate project. Y'all guess 1 week? By writing a blog? Like a simple Facebook post only,
5,000?
Oh, I make more than that.
Wow.
Yeah. Very funny, because, now, you see, the thing is this, Adam Koo's blog, a lot of people reading. You know what I'm saying? A lot of his followers reading. So when I write something bad about him, they'll be angry with me, they want to read, So when they go and read, then after that, right, then they go and share, and then after that, I actually make about $12,000 in 1 week. So I say, I you know what I do with this money? I take the money, I go and buy this company that time is called AIG. Then after that, I lost everything. Okay, so anyway, doesn't matter. It's a good start at that point in time. But at least the money I lost is from affiliate. But some of them eventually bounce back making money. Then I begin to help the affiliate, like even Cha, affiliate all people. All I do now the affiliate is so simple. I think some of y'all see my email or I put like Facebook posts. Actually a lot of them is affiliate link. So because I think that their products is not bad, people go and check it out, they buy. Actually I receive additional income. So my affiliate income also a couple of thousands every month. So thanks for following my Facebook. Then help me click on the link, okay? So but it's quite easy money. But all this money gives me capital to buy more stocks and then grow my wealth. So there are many different ways to do it. I think some of you have done it before. It's very funny.
And you know, I heard some very interesting story about affiliating, right? Where, for example, Tony Robbins, he also has his own online program. If I'm not wrong, one online program is about $2,000. And then some people...
Very funny. I tell you what I do. Chloe, you're exactly correct. After that, you know what I realized? I realized almost every program that you want to attend, right? Usually, they got affiliate program one. So that time I want to attend a Tony Robbins event. Then after that, right, his online one, online event, it costs about $2,000 plus, yeah, right?
Yeah.
So I went to search Tony Robbins affiliate. And then there's a way to actually sign up for affiliate link, you know. So I signed up for the affiliate link, then I affiliate myself, and then I got I think almost 20% or 10% discount from the program. So not bad. And then you guess what? Because I also affiliate his program, right? I became one of the top few affiliates. And one of the people I affiliate is actually myself. It's quite funny. So, hey, your thing is smart. If you want to attend something, go and check whether there's an affiliate program. You can actually get back some rebates. If you think it's smart, type smart. Okay? How do you start affiliate from zero? Yeah. Well, now very simple. Now got Facebook. Easy already. Or you just Google that program plus affiliate. Whatever program plus the word affiliate. Usually, there will be an affiliate program one. Okay? I mean, like a Tony Robbins affiliate, whatever affiliate.
Tony Robbins now, right? His e-course is 50%. So basically, you save $1,000. If you enroll yourself, you spend $2,000, right? But if you affiliate yourself, you get back $1,000. So basically, you only spend like $1,000 to enroll in a program you want to enroll. So I think that's the amazing part.
Mm.
Okay, thank you very much for watching. So like I say, just now somebody, Amy actually mentioned, right, I'm confused, we participated live for something pre-recorded. Yes, because Chloe is actually having her workshop on Saturday. So we decided, hey, why not today, you know, just give her, let her rest. But yet, you know, she was still very keen on sharing on Tencent because I heard from her that she told you guys last week that she'll be sharing on Tencent, right? So, right, remember just now during the program, actually Sean mentioned an ETF that actually invested in Tencent. And that ETF actually listed on US stock exchange. So right, during this Saturday, you can actually go and ask Chloe. Go and ask Chloe during her live workshop. Okay, on how to actually what exactly, which ARK is that? Okay, there are a few ARK, but you can ask Chloe which ARK is that. And without further ado, I'm going to show you how you can actually sign up for that workshop. Okay, so you can see, right, you can go to you can actually go to Facebook and type in Next Level All Stars, short form Endless. Okay, type in Next Level All Stars, and then you scroll down, click, look at the announcement, you click on the first one, and then you can click into this link to actually register. Okay, so when you click onto this link, it will prompt you into the registration page. If you have problems registering, feel free to type on the comment and I will help you. Okay, so this workshop will happen. Okay, it will happen this Saturday at 10 to 12 p.m. Okay, it will be on ETF. Okay, ETF. All right, and it will be done by Chloe. It will not be recorded on Facebook. That means it won't be kept here on this Facebook. But if let's say you want to get access, a lifetime access to the recording, you can actually go to this link and register, and then we will tell you. We'll send you an email on how to actually register for this workshop. Okay, cool. And that will be all for tonight. We hope that you have enjoyed the session. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for watching and staying through. I have learned a lot, and I hope you guys have also learned a lot from Sean and Chloe as well. And tomorrow there will be no show. Rudy is on a break because tomorrow is a Hari Raya. So to our Malay friends, Selamat Hari Raya. And that's about it. And I will see you guys again. And thank you so much for watching. Goodbye. Good night. Have a long weekend and have a good break. Bye-bye.